Welcome to your Wednesday One show live on BBC One and iPlayer with Alex Jones.
And Roman Kemp. Now, you may have seen something doing the rounds on social media. It's an optical illusion. So, first you see squares, and then, if you're special, you can see circles. No, I couldn't.
What?
But hang on. Right, look at it, right?
It's squares.
Look
it looks hard. Like, it looks
yeah,
like a bar of chocolate.
On. Then, see, you look closer, and then this happens. And then all you can see is circles.
That's cheating!
No, but take it away. There you go.
Oh!
See?
Oh,
OK.
Well, that's going to take me a while afterwards.
What are you seeing, Matt?
I'm seeing red. Thanks to the gizmos that claim to save you money on your fuel and energy, but don't. Also, factor 50 quid. Why you shouldn't fall for the expensive sunslap claptrap. And I'll have the places where you and your kids can eat cheap or even free this summer.
Oh, thanks very much, Matt. And look, it was euphoria for the England women's football team this week. Yes! They achieved a record win at the Euros and are now on their way to the quarter-finals. And tonight, Lionesses midfielder Jill Scott joins us alongside the wonderful Gabby Logan to tell us what's in store for the team.
And later on, we'll also be joined by space scientist Maggie Aderin-Pocock as she reveals why tonight's moon is one you don't want to miss.
Ooh, love a bit of space stuff.
You do,
love
don't
it.
You?
Yeah, and to something else that would also be quite hard to miss. Take a look at this very unusual fish. Yeah, me neither. It's older than a dinosaur and is best known as the vampire of the sea. Later, we'll find out how the endangered species is actually making a comeback.
And as always, we do love to hear from you. Perhaps you've got a space question for Maggie. You've got plenty.
Yes, loads.
Or maybe you've got a stunning picture of the sky at night like the ones we're surrounded by this evening in the studio. Now, here's another one from Matt Cardy. This one's nice. Look.
Oh.
Look at how big that moon is.
Or is it a very small castle?
Maybe. Maybe it's a fish tank. Who knows? But first tonight, lots of people are looking for ways to save money. But Matt, there is always somebody ready to take advantage, isn't there?
Oh, yes, Al. And it's really not OK, you know, to use the current astronomic fuel and energy prices as a way to squeeze money out of people. When I find those who use sham science and claim to make your savings but don't, I get quite annoyed. And when it involves some of the world's biggest online marketplaces, Amazon and eBay, well, they have to take some of the blame too. But there's an old saying that I've just made up. He who has access to genuine scientists has the last laugh.
For many of us, money's getting tighter and tighter at the moment.
Luckily, there is a seemingly miraculous range of products available on Amazon or eBay here to save the day. This one, the sellers claim, if you plug it into your wall, will save you up to 30% of your electricity consumption. And this one, the sellers claim, if you plug it into your vehicle, will save you 15% of your fuel spend. So what do you make of that, people of Coventry?
Just buy this one plug. Wow.
Yeah, I'll give it a go. You haven't really got anything to lose.
That would be good if it did actually saved the money.
Yeah.
I'd keep it plugged in.
These products are sold online for between £5 and £20. As fuel and energy prices reach their highest in decades, there are thousands of similar listings. But do they really work? I've come to Coventry University, where Jeff Peters, senior lecturer in motorsport engineering, is going to help me put the so-called fuel-saving chip through its paces.
So, Jeff, tell me what we're doing here.
What we've done is put a car on the rolling road and driven it at 40 miles an hour for 5 miles. We get a fuel consumption figure of 62.7 miles per gallon. Now we're going to fit this in the diagnostic port, and then you're going to drive for another 5 miles and see what fuel consumption you get with this device installed in the car.
It's hardly the ride of a lifetime, but once the test is done, Jeff crunches the numbers.
We got a figure of 62.7 miles per gallon, which is identical to without a device in there at all. We've tested a number of devices. We've had no variation in fuel consumption figures. Nothing changed at all.
You've looked inside. What's in there?
Yeah, well, now I've had a look inside. All we've got is a couple of transistors and some resistors and some lights. And if you look closely, the pins aren't even soldered to connect to the car. So what we've got is a box with lights.
Fuel prices are ridiculous. People are really struggling. Is there a gadget that can make real savings?
To have one device that you can plug into any car to improve on what the manufacturer spent years developing, it's just not possible to do that.
So that's fuel dealt with, no savings to be had. But it turns out there is more than one very clever person here at Coventry University. There's a great big plug for you, Rashid.
Thanks, Matt.
Dr. Rashid Ali is a lecturer in aeronautical electrical engineering, which explains the Harrier jump jet in his lab. He's examining the energy-saving household plugs.
We have a dummy load simulating the sort of appliances that you might have in a domestic environment. If the current drawn by the circuit goes down, then you'll be saving money. If it goes up, you'll be spending more money. So when I plug this energy-saving device in and turn it on, it's actually drawing more current, which basically means it's actually costing you money.
Rashid, we gave you a number of these devices to check. What did you find?
Most of the devices that we tested were sat there on our sockets consuming power. One of them will cost you near enough £120 a year.
So the claim that's made for this is that it's going to save us up to 30% of our consumption.
I think that claim is a little preposterous. There is no way it can save you 30% of your energy bill.
When we put that to Amazon, it told us that while its third-party sellers are independent businesses, they mustn't provide misleading information, and it's investigating. And eBay told us it had removed from its site listings which didn't comply with product safety standards, and it's reviewing whether to prohibit these product categories. We also contacted all the sellers. Some told us they stand by their products. Others offered a full or partial refund, and others didn't respond.
Amazon and eBay, you've got to take responsibility for highly technical products making claims your customers can't possibly check themselves. And for us, if we really want to save money, not buying things like this is a very good place to start.
So there you have it. The gadgets which can save you money are few and far between, and just because they appear on familiar sites, it doesn't make their claims any truer.
So rip-off.
Yeah. I mean, certainly when it comes to, like, autumn time, because, you know, it's all right now.
Yeah.
But come October, they're going to be through the roof, the bills, aren't they?
Yeah, that's right. And you can imagine that, you know, we should make the most of the sunshine now, because there will be more fakers, more chiselers trying to squeeze money out of us with gadgets like that. Amazon and eBay have said they'll get rid of these dodgy gadgets or gizmo. But if you spot any still doing the rounds, please let us know. Watchdog at bbc.co.uk and at BBC Watchdog on Twitter. Now, to a very different kind of technology, we've been looking at menopause testing kits. There are plenty being advertised, and they are easily available on the high street. They typically sell for about 10 quid each.
Yeah, now, I was really lucky. My mum has always spoken very openly about the menopause with my family. So, I mean, surely, you know, something like this is good, right? Get more awareness out there as well?
Yeah, and it's starting to be something that we are talking about much, much more. The test kits would be brilliant if they could tell you that with accuracy, whether you're in the middle of menopause or perimenopausal or not. But that's where the problem starts. The kits test your urine for levels of a hormone called FSH. But the British Menopause Society told us that while they do exactly that, FSH levels fluctuate naturally, and it won't tell you if you are peri or menopausal. NICE, the National Institute for Healthcare Excellence, says tests shouldn't be used by women over the age of 45 because a doctor looking at your symptoms will give you a better diagnosis. Finally, every test we could find makes it clear that you should confirm the results of any test with your GP anyway.
Well, of course. I mean, if you're thinking, oh, I wonder what these symptoms are, you'd go to the GP, wouldn't you? Why bother with the kits at all?
Yeah, that's, of course, if you can get an appointment, but that would be free.
Good point.
The question is whether these tests should describe themselves as menopause tests at all if they come with all the reservations we've talked about. Right. Also, while we're casting an eye over things you might buy at the chemists, sunscreen. My colleagues at Morning Live have discovered that paying more for sun creams, particularly enhanced water-resistant sun protection, that are often more expensive, doesn't always make sense. They aren't always worth it. They applied both types of sun cream, the basic and the enhanced, and moved their hands in and out of salt water for an hour, then examined the results under UV light. The best results came from Boots and Asda, their normal brand, with their own brand stuff, which is up to £10 cheaper.
Ooh.
I've heard that.
See, I'm a sucker for the cool bottles, though. Do you know? The
yeah.
Don't do it.
I know. Well, I only learned...
Don't do it.
I only learned... I don't know if this was, you know, a weird thing to learn at my age, but SPF, what it actually means. You know, you get factor 15,
yep.
30, 50. I didn't realise that it's like the time that it takes you to burn. If you've got SPF 15, factor 15, it's that time times 15.
There you go.
And then times 30, and then times 50.
Just factor 50 the whole way.
Yeah.
No messing.
Yeah, because then it's like, if you've got 10 minutes, you're good for 500 minutes.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And very important, don't forget to reapply. That's it. Every day's a school day, right?
Yes, okay. Exactly.
While we are handing out the incredibly rare gongs, we rarely do this on Watchdog, but we are going to say big up to the firms who are making it easier for families to eat this summer. Asda Cafe, hot and cold kids' meals for a quid.
Woo-hoo!
Morrison's, free meal for one child if you have an adult meal over a fiver.
Woo-hoo!
Beefeater and Brewer's Fair, free breakfast for two children with every paying adult.
Woo-hoo!
If you've heard of another whoop, give us the scoop at BBC Watchdog, because we love you and we want you to be OK, basically. We've got one more little bit of good news to end. Last month, we featured the story of Perfect Pet insurance customer Hugh and his Cocker Spaniel Jasper. Perfect Pet had rejected a claim Hugh submitted on the grounds that Jasper was overweight, despite his vet saying he was nothing of the sort. Well, I am pleased to say that Perfect Pet has now gone back on its original decision and has now paid out, recognising the vet statement that Jasper is not, in fact, a chunky chappy.
Remember that, and he wasn't.
He wasn't.
Thank you.
Slim is a
very
weasel.
Very good.
Yeah.
Matt, thank you so much, mate.
Pleasure.
And do you know what? You'll like this one, because as a fellow football fan, you'll know there's a real buzz in the air at the minute when it comes to women's football, as on Monday, England won 8-0 against Norway at the Euros.
Yes, football could be coming home for the team as they now through to the quarterfinals. So before we speak to England midfielder Jill Scott and the woman who's been following all the action, Gabby Logan, let's remind ourselves of that epic win. Well. Welcome both. And Jill, congratulations. Absolutely epic. How does it feel to watch that back?
No, it still gives us goosebumps now. I think we were all a bit in disbelief, really. Obviously, the first goal went in, then 2, 3, 4. I think it was 6-0 at half-time. And I think we all looked at each other and was just like, what is happening? But, yeah, it was a great performance from the girls and obviously fantastic to get another 3 points.
Oh, so good. And Gabby, I think Ian Wright kind of summed things up, and he actually gave us a really weird way to remember the name of the person that scored some of the goals. Take a look at this.
Beth Mead!
He's just a Beth Mead super fan, isn't he? I mean, Gabby, what was that atmosphere like?
Yeah, well, obviously, he's a bit of a gooner, isn't he? And Beth Mead is a gooner. And there's quite a lot of gooners, actually, around the other night, because Jonas Eidevall, the Arsenal ladies manager, was there as well, and Alex Scott. So it was just such a celebration, such a joyous atmosphere. And, you know, the whole night felt kind of just an excitable air to it. And he personifies that, doesn't he, Ian Wright? He absolutely loves the women's game. He loves being there in the stadium and kind of lapping up that atmosphere. It felt like a real celebration of football. You know, the game has come such a long way, the women's game. I started presenting for the BBC for women's football back in 2007. And, you know, the crowds, the standard of play, what the expectations are for this team have just gone kind of through the roof. You know, it's been an incredible journey. And to be there in that stadium, you know, and Jill Scott, by the way, has been there almost all the way. She's like, I've got the most incredibly enduring career ever. We can't believe we were so happy she was on the pitch the other night because she has been through a lot of this journey. And it just felt like a moment in time. You know, 8-0 is a ridiculous scoreline to beat a team like Norway, but they were so brilliant. They were sublime.
And Jill, talk to us then about after the game, about the atmosphere in the locker room, because apparently you played a bit of ABBA to celebrate.
We can't talk about that. No, we always like to have a little bit of music after the game. So, yeah, I think Rach Daly was singing and stuff like that. Because I think it is important that you just celebrate them small wins along the way. I was a little bit gutted because I'm a massive Boyzone fan, so I wanted to play some of their music, but the girls said it wasn't up-tempo enough. And I have to be honest, they said I was getting interviewed by RK today and I was hoping it was Ronan Keaton, so I'm sorry, Ronan.
I'll see you later. Should I stay? It's OK.
We'll have to get you back on, Jill. Ronan will be chuffed.
Yeah,
hopefully.
Yeah.
Just for nine-year-old Jill, she's a massive Boyzone fan.
Oh, 100%. Well, look, I kind of want to go back to that. I mean, going back to nine-year-old Jill there, I mean, you know, what, Jill, as a youngster growing up, was it your family that got you into football? I mean, was it just a natural love straight away for you?
Yeah, it was a natural love, I think. It was a lot of playing with the boys in the schoolyard. He's a map behind us and I'm right up in the northeast in Sunderland, very proud to be from there. And football's such a massive part of everyone's lives in the northeast. So just love playing it. But yeah, it was playing with the boys a lot of the time because there wasn't a lot of girls. And now to see how many girls are playing football and the opportunities that are out there for them, it's so pleasing, especially for me. As Gabby says, I've been around a long time and I feel so fortunate to have kind of seen the growth in the game and live it as well, playing for England.
So you're playing Northern Ireland on Friday night, but you're through anyway, aren't you? How are you feeling about that match now then, Jill?
I think our focus as soon as we got back to the hotel, it has to turn to the next game because obviously, you know, in tournaments, it's not just about one game. So, yeah, the girls are excited, had training today, we'll train tomorrow and then obviously going into that game. The fans have been incredible. So I think everyone's just excited to get back out there and obviously have the fans there cheering us on again.
And really briefly, Gabby, do you think the Lionesses have what it take to go all the way?
What they showed us the other night, absolutely. But this is tournament football. When we get to the quarterfinal stages, you know, it's knockout. So we could be going to extra time. We could be going to penalties. What happened last night, Alex, was that Germany won their group, which means that England won't face them in the quarterfinals. I think we'd all secretly love to see that as the final at Wembley on the 31st of July. That's the one I'm praying for. But, you know, it's sport. We don't write the scripts. Anything can happen. But the way they played the other night was just sublime, as I say. So more of that, please, Jill. Can you just pass that on?
Yeah, please, please do. And Jill, if you do that, I'll make sure it's Ronan here next time. All right, don't you worry.
Deal.
Otherwise, I'll be at the training ground. I'll sing Love is a Roller Coaster just for you lot. Look, thanks so much, Jill and Gabby. And you can watch the Women's Euros weeknights here on BBC One.
I love that she was so honest about it.
I'm dying inside.
Anyway, still to come tonight, space scientist Maggie Aderin-Pocock tells us why tonight's moon is set to be the biggest and brightest of the year.
Yeah, now, closer to home, it's time to meet a creature that actually looks like it should come from space.
Yes, now, if you saw one, you'd probably run a mile. But, as Lizzie Daly discovered, looks can be deceiving.
This is the River Severn in Gloucestershire, and at this time of year, it becomes the breeding ground for a fish that's 200 million years older than the dinosaurs. The sea lamprey is a primitive jawless fish. River pollution drove them out of many of our rivers, but now they're making a comeback. Adult lamprey migrate from the Atlantic Ocean upriver to spawn. Monitoring their return is Chris Banger and his team at the Environment Agency.
They're really important to this river. They're one of our rare fishes, and they're one of our fish that rely on the sea and fresh water to complete their life cycle. Because water quality is improving, we have seen more coming back to the river.
The life cycle of a sea lamprey is pretty impressive.
Yeah, when the sea lamprey goes to sea, it's looking for food. It can be things like whales, basking sharks, and it will latch onto them and it will suck the blood. But when they come back to the river at this time of year, we know that they're off to go spawning.
Dr. Jamie Dodd from Hull University has been tracking their migration here on the River Severn. In April, he tagged 65 sea lamprey as they entered the river.
These pings are coming from the tag that we've put inside the sea lamprey.
It's here right now?
Probably within 200 metres of us. So
okay.
I can go back to my tagging sheets and then we'll be able to see what sort of movements it's made in the last few weeks.
By tracking their movements, Jamie has discovered a major stumbling block to their migration.
they'll reach a barrier such as this one behind me, and they'll hold up to 2 weeks.
Because it is a barrier?
Yes, and we notice that after they've approached it, they may go back downstream, then come back upstream and try again. It's really important that we try and minimise that delay.
Lamprey only have a short window to spawn. Any delay can affect their breeding success. So a fish pass has been fitted to help them navigate the weir and head upstream.
They're no risk to us, are they, when we're in the water?
Absolutely not. No. These animals are not out there to get us, so there's no need for us to be scared of them.
What are we looking for? How big can they get?
Well, I'm hoping that we'll see some today that'll probably be about a metre long. And certainly almost as thick as your arm.
And it's not long before we have our first visitor.
We got a lamprey.
This adult lamprey is gripping onto the weir with its mouth against the current. And by using the fish pass, it can safely continue its journey upstream. So we're heading up there too, where they should be breeding and spawning. And in the shallows, we've spotted 3 adult lamprey.
Here we go.
Then a rare sight.
Look, they're mating.
They're mating!
To mate, the male latches onto the female with its mouth and wraps his body around hers, ensuring that he fertilises the eggs as she lays them. Lamprey use their sucker-like mouths to make a stone nest called a red.
I cannot believe what I'm seeing. Prehistoric fish, and they migrate from huge distances out to sea, here to beneath my feet. This is the prime behaviour that you really want to see with such an amazing species.
What we've got in here.
Oh, wow!
Chris's team has managed to catch 2 lamprey that have already spawned. They're nearing the end of their life cycle, so we're able to handle them.
Just hold your hand in just a little bit more closely. Can you feel the pressure of that water that they're pumping through their gills?
That's really quite a force coming out of those gills.
It is fast
as well.
And it's these mouth parts that are just absolutely phenomenal, aren't they?
Those rows and rows, and you can even see the barbed tongue just there as well.
Time to get these lamprey back in the river. And under Chris's supervision, I've been given the honours.
Off you go!
Wow, great job.
Yes!
Despite their ferocious appearance, these really are gentle creatures.
This has been such a special experience to get an up-close look at this prehistoric creature, and to see them returning to our rivers is incredible.
Now, you might want to forget what you just saw there. They're not the prettiest, but you might want to look at the sky tonight, because the moon is set to be absolutely spectacular.
It is indeed, yes. It's known as a supermoon. But what does that actually mean? Well, joining us now to tell us more is space scientist Maggie Aderin-Pocock. Welcome, Maggie. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Very good. So tell us all then about a supermoon.
Yes. So a supermoon is bigger and brighter than the average moon we see in the night sky. And so it's when you have a full moon that's bigger and brighter. And it's bigger and brighter because it's closer to us. Now, to explain that, I've got some marbles. I always travel with marbles. So if this is the Earth and this is the moon, the moon sort of just orbits the Earth, and we're sort of aware about that. But most people think that the moon goes around the Earth in a circle. But it doesn't actually go around in a circle. It goes in what's a slightly squished circle called an ellipse. And that means that sometimes the moon is closer to the Earth and sometimes the moon is further away. When we get a supermoon, it's because we happen to have a full moon, and we happen to have a full moon when the moon is closer to the Earth than usual.
Right.
And I'm talking about sort of maybe 42,000 miles closer. But it does mean the moon looks bigger in the sky and also looks brighter, about 30% brighter.
So if someone says, because a lot of people say, is it just an optical illusion? Is it still an optical illusion, or is it actually bigger?
It's actually bigger because it is closer to the Earth. But there is an optical illusion that many people observe. And that's when you look at the moon, or sort of when it first rises in the night sky, and you sort of see it close to the horizon, it looks absolutely massive. And it looks massive because we're seeing the moon sort of with other things that we're familiar with, like church spires, trees, that sort of thing.
Yeah.
But as it moves up further into the night sky, there's no reference points. And so the moon appears smaller. But you can do a very simple test. If you take a coin and hold it up to the moon and sort of just about cover the moon when it's low on the horizon, and then do exactly the same when it's high, you'll see that your hand is the same distance from your eye, so the moon is exactly the same size.
Oh, see, there you go. Now, but this supermoon, It's a super, super moon, isn't it? It's really special.
It is an extra special super moon because it is the largest super moon that we're going to have this year. Because it depends on when... I mentioned sort of, you know, sometimes the moon is closer. It depends on exactly when the moon is at closest approach to the Earth. And when it's at closest approach, if that's when you get your full moon, that means that the moon is even sort of bigger and brighter than usual.
Right. Oh. And isn't it something that the moon is constantly moving away from us?
It is. Now, there's nothing to worry about, but as the moon orbits the Earth, it is actually spiralling away from us very slowly. So it's moving away from the Earth about the same rate our fingernails grow. So about sort of 3.6 centimetres a year.
Wow.
So very slowly. But it does mean that given, let's say, 100, 1,000 years' time, supermoons will actually be smaller. But as the moon is spiralling away from us, there's something called conservation of angular momentum. But it means that the Earth is slowing down.
Right.
Ah.
So if you go back thousands, actually millions of years, when the moon was first formed, a day on Earth was only about 5 hours. And as the moon has been spiralling away from us, the Earth is getting slower and slower, and it will continue to slow down. So an Earth day won't be 24 hours. It will be something more.
Honestly, it's fascinating.
That is mind-blowing.
Honestly, it's fascinating speaking to you. It's such a privilege. Thank you so much. One thing I do want to say, though, is that you'll be very modest about this. Tell me about yesterday. You were a part of history.
Yeah.
You were the big space news. Tell us about it.
So I was a part of history in terms of one of 10,000 other scientists, but it was a massive moment for us because we got the first images from the James Webb Space Telescope. And I sort of worked on the James Webb Space Telescope on sort of just one of the components. I was managing a team. We were building it, but it's out there and sort of out there in space and now is getting data, and the data was beautiful.
Gosh. Oh, I mean, we've got some of these pictures. I mean, what are we looking at here?
What is that?
Yeah, it does look very odd. But what we're seeing here... Yes, it is. And what we're seeing here is actually a dying star, which sounds quite sad. But stars are like people. They go through life cycles. They're born, they live and sort of prosper, and then they die. And that image was showing a sort of a star that's gone supernova. And what happens is the gravitational force, you know, holding the star together is balanced by another force of fusion pushing the star outwards. And when it runs out of fuel, the star, if it's big enough, goes supernova and splashes elements out into the universe. Yes. But the fascinating thing is that those elements then go to make you, me, everything in this room. We are literally stardust because the elements in our body were made in the heart of stars.
We're going to have to stop there because minds are blown all over the country. That was amazing. Thank you, Maggie. You can see Maggie tomorrow night in Super Telescope, Mission to the Edge of the Universe on BBC Two at 8 o'clock.
That's all we've got time for. Thank you so much to all of our guests.
And we will see you tomorrow. Bye-bye.